What would you do if a sudden wave of illness began causing everyone you know to develop angry rashes and explosions of the abdominal and face areas? This one is likely to get more disturbingly brutal than you would expect. We open with some newscast exposition about some fairly significant bird and fish kills. Huge swaths of fish are washing up, and birds are dying where they fly and plummeting to the earth. These events, of course, could not be ignored, but you don't even know what they have worked to keep from the public eye. It starts for us with a Skype call to Donna Thompson, and it started for her covering a 4th of July festival in Claridge, Maryland. But for her, even the remembering is difficult. It was so horrible. But once she gets going, we learn that thanks to govleaks.org, all of the digital evidence she curated that no one wanted to see is now available for anyone, and she can't rest until the truth of what happened to this quaint coastal town is revealed. It's a friendly town where folks visited to get tatted up. Most people caught crabs at some point in their trip, and even the mayor, John Stockman, is easily accessible by his constituents. Donna was there as an intern to explore the boardwalk and preserve the local history in a time before it was overrun by TikTok pranksters and just good folks having good fun. Like Mayor Stockman, a simple man whose face hides an obvious deep-seated perversion of some sort. The problems had begun sometime earlier when two divers were found floating in the bay. They had been oceanographers who were monitoring the pollution levels of the water. Their exploits were captured in video diary entries that they had been providing at regular intervals. Due to portions of their tasty torso meat being gone, it was presumed they were victims of a shark attack, even though that would be very unusual for the area, and the injuries were inconsistent with this. Their findings had revealed all kinds of nasty crap in the water, partially exacerbated by a strong warm undercurrent, helping it all spread around. The primary source seemed to be production plant runoff that was dumping right into the town's swimming hole. Yeah, but what's the worry? It's no big deal. Susan's kids swim out there. In 45 million pounds of chicken shit, per this guerrilla activist looking to record the chicken plant's misdeeds. But that's the bay. Claridge has a robust desalination plant that makes everything clean and clear for public use and consumption. So they're covered. And everyone in the public has been consuming it and going about their daily business. Right up until that fateful day when Judy comes staggering out onto the main thoroughfare, just melting as the gawkers gawk and, almost universally, also begin to experience their bodies rejecting the putrid slurry. Dr. Abrams was the lead ER doctor that day, and he treated 350 patients before dropping dead from being excessively grossed out. He did engage with the CDC, though, and connected with the boils and lesions expert to try to help triage. As they work to gather whatever info they can, the police record the first death. Meanwhile, far from the devastation, Alex and Stephanie prepare to head up the coast to visit the grandparents and enjoy the fireworks. There had been no broader announcement of the festival's cancellation due to everyone vomiting blood. The emergency infrastructure of the small tourist town is stretched to its breaking point as the symptoms spread and escalate.
Her guts were tore out and her tongue cut off.
Donna tries to leverage this as an opportunity to report on something substantive, but has trouble connecting with the working man. Elsewhere, Alex and Stephanie cast off for their 7-hour voyage.
We're gonna go and see Grandma and Grandpa?
Well, and we find Jennifer left alone by her parents and FaceTiming with her bestie about the painful rash that's spreading all over her body. The footage then cuts back to the oceanographers, who have acquired an infected fish and are about to scope it. It's found to be riddled with larvae from an indeterminate parasite.
I've never really seen larvae like this, though. I don't know where the parasites are coming from.
Information about this novel discovery was provided to Mayor Stockman, but it's never confirmed whether he did anything with it. Back in the streets of Claridge, there are now reports coming in of what's being described as a second mutilation, based on the condition of the bodies they're finding. Donna finds herself chasing down these reports without an actual clue of what to do. While at the hospital, Abrams is giving a live view of the bacteria eating out its victims from the inside, and the CDC boys appear to be shook. But as luck would have it, everything is all good. They just don't realize this yet. You see, despite the reports of painful rashes and violent murders, this is all just a simple bacteria causing a little discomfort. There's really no need to worry so much. Just try to vibe out, if possible, says Mayor Stockman over the airwaves. And everyone does basically go about their business. The oceanography report, however, finds the bacteria levels to be frightfully high and likely being fed and supported by significant fertilizer runoff. They also find strange mutilated fish. Strange because fish don't bite other fish. They respect their fellow fishes. And with complete chaos and confusion in little pockets here and there, Alex and Stephanie continue their forward progression toward doom, running across strange sights along the way. They are unable to reach anyone on the mainland, so they keep going. Elsewhere, we come upon the waterlogged footage of a couple of hopeful future viral social media influencers taking some private videos. To properly demonstrate how far she's willing to go, she removes 50% of her clothing and then jumps into the murky waters. As some unseen entities nibble at her and her boyfriend jumps in after, this video, found later on the beach, becomes the only evidence to confirm that they ever even existed. On a completely unrelated note, we catch some additional private footage. This one is from Alex and Stephanie, who, seeking some sort of entertainment to help pass the time on this long voyage, play a little game of grab ass on deck that results in Alex taking a tumble into the water. He delights in splashing about and letting the refreshing brackish water slosh all around in his mouth and gullet. It's revealed that 40% of the bay is a dead zone. Nothing can live there. And then transitions back to the CDC. They are circling back with Abrams, who has confirmed an escalation of both cases and symptoms. All the CDC can do is recommend they hold tight, but meanwhile, the patients are losing their tongues to whatever this is. Speaking of which, someone conveniently edited in some footage of the oceanographers cracking open a fresh specimen from the brackish waters. This vessel contains an abnormally large isopod of some type that seems to have feasted upon and replaced the tongue and interior of the fish. This, in turn, gives further insight into a situation where a guy posts an Insta story of his belly bulging and gyrating in a rhythmic manner. This incubation phase seems to be hitting many early cases at about the same time we see. Meanwhile, the CDC is closing in on a possible answer to the what question. They've identified a rare and nasty little bacterium that causes similar symptoms. It doesn't melt out the afflicted's tongue, but it does tend to leave them with no arms or legs. News of the unfortunate situation we hear is left in a voicemail from Stephanie's mom, but she never hears it. However, to be fair, there are other signs warning them away. Although the water is fairly calm in comparison to the absolute hell that's breaking out inland, a backdrop to the CDC casually discussing the issue. They connect with a local EPA consultant who confirms all the various ways in which the bay has been contaminated over time. This is all on top of a prior radiation leak from a nearby power plant. Sure, they desalinate and whatnot, but filters don't remove radiation. Plus, it's enough that you can't really stop it from seeping into the groundwater. The people don't know that, but they flee anyway, as if they can outrun the pestilence incubating inside the cavities of their bodies. And at any rate, the bridge is shut down by an unknown authority, so no one ever makes it across. Donna then goes official guerrilla journalist, as she gets an email demanding no more blogging. She is a huge proponent of the First Amendment, so she goes in hard, but is almost immediately sidetracked by distant sounds of wailing carrying on the wind. The police are trying to manage this, but the screams are really coming from everywhere, so they take an organized approach, heading directly to their first call. There is no response from inside, so the front door is breached. Shots are fired, and the silence of the radio confirms that no backup is on the way. While inside, it's all chaos and creepy crawlies.
It's crawling on those people.
Back at the CDC, it's revealed that some of the information from our friendly oceanographers did seep through into their greasy little hands. The problem is, they just didn't know what to do with it. Then we get confirmation that what originally compelled the scientists to enter what they knew to be dangerous waters was their natural curiosity. The calm surface belies the terror deep below, and they plunge down and almost immediately get caught up in a school of full-grown isopods that quickly eviscerate them to death. Donna's lower back is on fire from standing on the dock all day, so she hobbles toward a nearby saloon that seems to be open for business, albeit with moans of agony emanating from within. Wouldn't you know it, a TikTok prankster hits her with the classic blood-in-your-mouth gag. Donna has to consider which is worse here, blood or water. They find another guy who tried to make that choice, and the shock of it sends them screaming into the night and ending our official news footage. This is the point where we have now crested the hill and are in our downward slide into oblivion. The CDC recommends Dr. Abrams and his staff evacuate, leaving the patients behind as they are a lost cause. Abrams already dismissed his staff, but insists on going down with the ship. Jennifer confirms from the stairwell that the situation is desperate, with a dawning realization that no help is coming and everyone is going to die. It's against this backdrop at around 9 p.m., and despite an abundance of floaters in the water, that Alex and Stephanie begin to dock. Luckily, Stockman and the chief are working to regain control of the town. The plan is to keep things under wraps to avoid further panic and see if they can ride it out. Not sure how this will translate for our virgins of calamity, who are more upset about the lack of a greeting and fireworks show upon their arrival. I mean, over 700 people have died, and here's one of them now. Alex, the little freak, can't stop filming it. With no gas left in the boat, they feel as though they should carry on. This is a good idea, because there is no safer place for a baby than a graveyard after dark, as they say. They soon find refuge in an open but empty antique store, full of many curios with an abundance of compartments Victorians used to hide their babies, so pretty perfect. Adding one more layer to this, the CDC harkens back to simpler times when we were mainly talking about chicken excrement, and adds the forced multiplier of excessive steroids used to bring the livestock to maturity. The inclusion of this element could have acted as an evolutionary aggravator. Back with the chief and mayor, we find they're having a hard time making sense of what happened to all the officers they once commanded, and the mayor practically drools over the chance to fire them all once they're done with this bothersome disaster. Speaking of which, they roll up on a squad car. The chief tries to figure out what's up when Jim staggers out and tries to warn them away. Unfortunately for the chief, he has a strong impulse to never leave a man behind. Unfortunate because once he makes contact and becomes unsavable, old Jim hooks his boy up with an unsolicited mercy killing, which is traditionally served up in a two-pack. This gives Stockman something to ponder, but only momentarily. The good mayor is soon speeding down the road in an attempt to abandon the town that he has abandoned. He fails to exercise due care and, as a result, never makes it out alive. Dr. Abrams is now the last man standing at the hospital. The CDC has declined to return any of his calls at this point. He confirms that he's isolated the problem to a whole-ass organism rather than a simple virus or fungus. Those who contract the larvae are being consumed from the inside out. Now that he's also afflicted, he's simply trying to put together as much information and evidence as possible before he gives birth. Back at the store, they've managed to get through to Bill, their old friend. It's hard for him to wrap his head around the fantastic story they're telling him. Plus, he's really distracted by the giant goiter developing on Alex's neck. It doesn't take long for Alex to start puking his guts out. And despite the thumping of a possible rescue chopper outside, he insists Stephanie finish him off in a brutal fashion. She does oblige, and Bill doesn't seem capable of mustering much more than a mild bemusement. They must have just been work acquaintances. Finally, we hear from Homeland Security. They had been working on some early cases from about 6 weeks back, throwing our whole timeline into complete chaos here. But no determination was ever made, so they just sort of let it go. I mean, you can't just set up stations and shut down towns. You need approval from a higher authority, and that involves them doing their job, which is gross. This exposition overlays Stephanie's attempts to find some sort of means of exiting the town. She makes a concerted effort, but seems to fail or run into complications at every turn, despite her natural drive to protect her baby. We learn the National Guard eventually came and quarantined the area. They confiscated evidence and choked out the organisms by chlorinating the water. The survivors of the incident reached a financial agreement with the government that included a pretty airtight non-disclosure agreement. Because of that, this is the first time any of this information has been made public. Well, that was brutal, but if you're looking to go deeper than that, be sure to check out this video next. Now that we're here, I want to congratulate you for making it to the end of the video and affirm that you are a very special person because of it. And if you enjoyed the video, I would love for you to become a part of the channel by subscribing. Thanks for watching.